sing until about the 11 o'clock worship service, so we had to get up real early this morning, but it was fun, wasn't it? Wasn't it, Debbie? Yes, it was. We live over in East Tennessee, near Gatlinburg, and I like to go to Gatlinburg every once in a while just to see the tourist. You know, you can always tell a tourist. They always have a 35-millimeter camera hanging around their neck and a T-shirt from somewhere else and golfer shorts and real white legs and black socks. You can always tell them. So I went over there a few weeks ago, and the Lord gave me this song from an experience I had. I saw on the street there that day a young man that was beginning to paint a picture. He had a canvas out, and he was just beginning to paint. I looked at the canvas, and I couldn't tell what he was going to paint. It was just kind of a mess of colors. And I passed him several times during the day, and each time I'd pass him, the picture would get clearer. By the end of the day, he had painted a masterpiece. I mean, it was one of the most beautiful mountain sceneries I'd ever seen. It was truly a work of art. You know what? I got to thinking about that. When I came to the Lord, my life was a mess. But you see, the master artist began to work with that. He began to do some detail work, smooth some rough edges, took out a little here and added a little here. See, he did a work of heart. He touched my heart that day. And I've never been the same since then. I met the artist years ago. He picked up the canvas and he painted slow. He never once took his eyes off of me. Then I did not understand. Oh, but now I plainly see he did a work of art. He painted love and sunshine, a work of art. He painted on this heart of mine, and though the colors they may fade, I know his love will not. You see, I am the canvas. He did a work of art. He brushed away the old life just to make room for new. Then he smiled and he promised me he wasn't through. All the sin and wrong that I done was then erased. He drew me into his gallery. He framed me in his grace. He did a work of art. He painted love and sunshine, a work of art. He painted on this heart of mine, and change that happened not long ago that I didn't like, and that's when they did away with old Coke. But I like the change that they've made. Now we're going to get the new Coke back. See, they took the fizz out. See, the Lord puts the fizz in when he changes your heart. I'm glad about the change that's taken place in my heart. Here's a brand new song that says, "There's Been a Change."
Skirts of town, the Lord was leaving Jericho when he happened upon blind Bartimaeus begging by the road. He was crying, "Lord, please have mercy on me." The Lord said, "Sight's not a problem for me.
question. How would these 2 million people be fed? How many bread trucks would it take to deliver bread sufficient for everyone to have bread enough and even to spare to their door every day? How many poultry farms would it take to raise chickens to feed 2 million people? How many stockyards or herds of cattle would it take that 2 million people in a city such as the city of Garland, if there were 2 million population, how many herds of cattle would it take to feed them every day, day after day, and week after week? And yet the Bible says that God, the children of Israel wandering there in the wilderness, that God met their need. Stephen Alford, a man, a preacher up north, has done some arithmetic and figured that God must have provided the children of Israel with at least 4,500 tons of food every day, that they would have food sufficient. Someone else has taken it and has worked out that 10 trains each having 30 cars and each car having in it 15 tons would be needed for a single day's supply of food for the children of Israel wandering there in their wilderness journey. And yet God met every one of their needs. No wonder Jesus said, "Take no thought for your life, what you shall eat or what you shall drink, nor yet for your body, what shall you wear? Behold the birds of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are ye not of more value than these?" No wonder the Apostle Paul possibly knew what he was talking about when he penned under the Holy Spirit of God, "My God shall supply all of your need according to his riches and glory." The psalmist said in Psalms 37, "I once was young, yet now I'm old, and I've not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread." Do you realize that the great God of the universe is able to do exceeding abundantly above anything that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us? So I see him here. As the children of Israel were in those wilderness journeys, you recall that never one starved to death. I mean, there was not a one that went hungry. There was not a one that went naked. There was not a need that was not met by our Heavenly Father. Now you take the context of the story. The feeding of the 5,000 fits right into the message of the entire Bible. I'll tell you, you take the Bible from the beginning to the end, and you'll find that God is sufficient, and when we walk with him by faith, that God will meet every need that we have. I like the story of the feeding of the 5,000. And in this story, I see at least three critical truths. I see in the first place that God's plan for meeting the needs of the world. "My God," Paul said, "shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus." I not only see God's plan for meeting the world's needs, but I see at the same time that we, his disciples, that God's plan for our lives in his great plan of meeting the needs of the world. I want us real hurriedly this morning to look at the story of the feeding of the 5,000 and see what we can glean from there that we might take and apply to our own lives. I see in the first place, as I open this story, a truth that is true throughout the entire Word of God. And that's this, that God loves you and God cares for you. You'll remember there that Jesus and his disciples, they had to go into a desert place for some R&R, some rest and relaxation. The people wouldn't even let them alone when they got there. All the people would gather about just to get a glimpse of that man of Galilee. They wanted to see Jesus and see who he was. There, not only did they gather close just to see him, but many wanted to touch him. They wanted to be healed by him. They wanted to be blessed by him. And as the crowd gathered in, the Bible says that Jesus saw the multitude as sheep without a shepherd. And the Bible says that he had compassion on them. And this is not the compassion. discovery that I ever made in my life was when I discovered the fact that I could not do one thing to make God love me more, and neither could I do anything to make God love me any less. Oh, I say to you, beloved sinner, this morning, that God loves you, and God is concerned about you. The Bible says that in the fullness of time, God sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law, in the likeness of man. And God loved you so much that he gave his Son. And 2,000 years ago, I see him there hanging on Calvary, suspended between heaven and earth. The earth is set up to say that we don't want you and we don't need you. And heaven is if to say, you're not good enough for this place. Though he hung there and he suffered and he bled and he died. And the death of Jesus Christ was sufficient for all of the sins of all of the world, but only efficient those that come unto God by him. Oh, the message still lost and a dying world today is this, that God loves you. Oh, God loves you so much. And herein is love, John said, not that we love God, but that he loved us and gave himself a sacrifice, a propitiation for our sins, not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. I read a story about Frederick Williams back years ago in the 18th century, the early part. He ruled in the nation of Prussia. There he had a name of being a very obese man that got around on a walking cane. And he was a man that was easily perturbed. He was a hard man and a hard ruler. It said that when he would walk down the streets, the people would dodge him. And they'd turn out of his way. They did not want to see him because he was easily perturbed. And if he was perturbed, he'd take his cane and just beat the people. It said that one day that Frederick Williams was walking down the streets of Berlin. And there he was. And a man that was walking down the street did not see him in time. And so he turned into a doorway to get away from Frederick William. Frederick William saw the man and he called out. And he said, you there, where are you going? And he said, into this house, your majesty. And he said, is it your house? And he said, no. He said, is it a friend's house? And he said, no. He said, well, why are you entering then? The poor citizen, afraid that he might get him for burglary or whatever, he decided to tell the truth. And he said, to get away from you, to avoid you, your majesty. Frederick William said, why would you want to avoid me? He said, because I fear you. It said that Frederick Williams turned purple with anger and began to beat the poor man with his walking stick. And he said, you scum, you're not to fear me, you're to love me. I think this morning that fits a lot of people in society today, that maybe they fear God. And yes, the Bible says the beginning of wisdom is fear of the Lord. But that's a reverential trust. We're to love God with all of our heart and with all of our soul and with all of our might. God so loved the world. And listen to me this morning. God loves you. And so the first message that I learned from the feeding of the 5,000 is this, that God cares and God loves you and God would give you the very desires of your heart if you'd only come to him and receive him. He's prepared and paid for our sins, and all we do is accept and receive that. He came unto his own received him not, but as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. Oh, dear friend, this morning, God loves you. I not only see that God loves us, I see also in this story of the feeding of the 5,000, the fact that it's God's plan for the multiplication of God's resources that he's given to us in the evangelization of the world. You'll recall there they came and they said, Lord, said the disciples, said to him, said, it's late in the evening now, and said, these people haven't had anything to eat. Said, should we let them go into the countrysides and the villages, and there they might find bread to eat? And Jesus said, what have you got? What's in your sat down, and the Bible said that Jesus looked up to heaven, and he blessed, and he divided them out. And everyone, when they had sufficient, he said, gather up what's left. And there was 12 baskets full left. Oh, I think about it this morning. When I open the Word of God, bread is associated with two things. There's two sides to it, the physical need. Oh, I look around the world today, and as a whole, in the 169 nations that we have, in over 50% of those nations, there are people that'll go to bed tonight hungry, and there's no need. There's plenty of food to feed all of the world. All we need to do is take the resources that God has already given us, and let God bless it, and then divide it. Oh, everyone will have sufficient to eat. I'll tell you, a lot of times we're living in a materialistic nation today. In the history of the world, there's never, never, never been a nation that is blessed materialistically like America has. I think about Ethiopia and wonder why America's been blessed, and in Ethiopia they're starving to death. And by the way, we're attempting to meet their physical needs today. But I go back in my mind about 15 years ago. There was a missionary named Richard Connor. Of his wife just died with cancer here about 3 or 4 months ago. Richard, every time he would come home, almost 20 years ago now, he would come and stay in my home. My daughters remember him real well. Richard was a missionary in Ethiopia. Richard would come home and he'd tell me he'd stay in our home for as much as 3 weeks at the time. Richard would say, preacher, pray for Ethiopia. They're going to close the door to the gospel. You study the history of Ethiopia. Back in Ethiopia, Ethiopia was a nation that was progressing. It was a progressing nation, and God was blessing Ethiopia. Oh, they threw all the missionaries out. I'll never forget the day that Richard called me. He'd sent his wife and his kids home, and Richard stayed under house arrest for 89 days. And they threw all of the missionaries out. And they killed two of God's choicest missionaries. We wonder today why Ethiopia is starving. You listen to me this morning. God owns everything. The earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof, and they that dwell thereof. You listen, Psalms 50, God said, if I were hungry, I would not ask thee. Was the beast of the forest or mine, saith the Lord, and all the cattle upon 1,000 hills are mine, saith the Lord. Haggai chapter 2, verse 8 and 9, the silver and the gold are mine, saith the Lord. I look at America today. I'll tell you as a whole, brother, there's no revival here. 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse number 14, God said, if my people, not the sinners, if my people, not the world, if my people, not the heathen, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face, then will I hear from heaven, and I'll heal their land. Oh, thank God, if there ever was a land that needed to be healed, it's in the day that we live. Oh, he said this, I take the story of the feeding of the 5,000. There's one thing that's prominent there, and that's this, that God cares for you. Also, God's plan for the multiplication of what God has given us in the evangelization of the world. Listen, bread in one sense is a physical need, and we don't have to go to Ethiopia. We don't have to go to a foreign country. You come with me after this service is over, and I'll take you downtown Garland, Texas, and I'll go 3 blocks from downtown Garland. And I'll carry you into the home of a man and a woman that's past 70 years old. Some of our church members have been there, and we've been taking care of them. And brother, they're living below the poverty level. Come on and go with me over in South Garland, and I'll show you some over there that literally go to bed at night hungry. Oh, I'll tell you, in a land that's aplenty, why aren't we doing something about it? Go down at Dallas Life Foundation, we're feeding more than 20,000 meals a month down there now. And I'll tell you, I told Brother Bailey, physical needs out there. There's some hurting people out there. Here we are. God has blessed us in a tremendous way. There's some people in this church. You could go to a nursing home. You say, oh, I can't preach, but you could go there and you could sit down and you could read to someone the Word of God, or maybe some good book that's lost their sight. You could go and you could lay your hands upon them and touch them, and you could let them know that you love them and that God cares for them. A lot of hurting people right in our own area. And yet, we've come to the place to where we don't even need God. We talk about humanism today. Oh, doctrinally, we're sound. Last night, I had about 40 people in my living room. I was sitting around and talking to them, and I said, humanism, it's taking our churches over. Kind of like the frog boiling in the water. Yeah, we're doctrinally sound. We say, oh, we believe in God, and we believe in the deity of God, and we believe God is everything. That's what we say we believe. But practically, we practice something else. Practically. You go up and down the streets of Garland, Texas, and I'll promise you that 8 out of 10 doors that you knock on, possibly 9 out of 10, that they're associated with some church. They're not in church on Sunday. And I believe this. You listen to me. I believe if you've got Jesus in your heart, you'll have something in your feet that'll carry you to church. I mean, I'm talking about physical needs. We need them. But not only was he talking about physical needs when he talked about the spoke of the bread. You remember the night of the Last Supper. He sat down with the disciples and he spoke to them. And he began to break the bread. And he handed it to him. And he said, this is my body, which is broken for you. Now, the world needs something more than physical needs. They need something more than a loaf of bread or a bottle of milk. The world needs Jesus Christ for sick. Christ my life, Christ my light, Christ both morning, noon and night. You know what this world needs? A good dose of Jesus. I mean, we've got to where we don't even get excited. We don't praise him anymore. We praise ourselves. Look what we do. Well, look at that great person. Boy, that God's person, we were responsible for that. I mean, we go around, I said, doctrinally, we were sound. But practically, we take all the glory. And God said, no man will steal my glory. Listen to me this morning. The world needs Jesus. Let me say that Jesus left. I see him. He was taken up, and there was 2 men that stood by him. And why to Pharaoh? Said, you men of Galilee, why stand you gazing into the heavens? The same Jesus was taken from you into heaven shall so come in like manner as you've seen him go into heaven. I was telling the choir last night, I sure miss Grandpa Johnson. He's been in heaven about 5 or 6 years now. He used to sit right over there about where my wife sits. That's that pretty woman in the red hat. And he would sit right over there, and every time I'd preach on the second coming of Christ, he'd jump up and talk back to me. He wasn't ashamed. I long for somebody to get up and run down these aisles and shout, glory to God. Remember, I used to preach. I'd say, he's coming back, and he'd jump up, and he'd point his finger at me, and he said, in the book of Daniel, chapter number 12, it said, boy, I'll tell you what, he'd start quoting scripture, and we'd have a good time. The world needs Jesus. Jesus left, and he went to heaven, and he limited himself to fellas just like you and I. That's the only way he has of getting the gospel out. He can't let down a loudspeaker out of heaven and preach the gospel. He could, but he won't. He's limiting himself to you and I. I mean, we're the bread. We have the souls of men in our hands. The souls of men. Do you realize there's 11 times as many in the world today as there was the entire population when he died on the cross? 30 times, and that line grows at the rate of 20 miles a day. Praise the population, none born and none died. If you could do that, and it would take 420 years to evangelize America alone, the rate we're going. It would take 4,487 years to evangelize the world. And yet Jesus said, whatever you need, I give it to you. All power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Sit still, I ain't through. It's 12 o'clock. You look at your watch and I'll shoot you with darts out of my eyes. Just hang in there. Old Dr. Sangster went around the world just a few weeks before he died. Had preached the gospel for more than 50 years, and he went around the world just a few weeks before he died. And he came back and they asked him, they said, Dr. Sangster, what impressed you the most? He said, I went all over the world and said, I did not see one hospital that was built by agnostics. Said, I did not see one nursing home that was built by atheists. But he said, everywhere I went, I saw the Church of Jesus Christ alive and functioning. Hallelujah. Every 3 seconds, there's 100 people that die and go to hell.